All right, I'm going to make this quick. I say this every time. I say it's going to be quick every time. And sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. Sometimes I can ramble and keep rambling. Anyway, that's the nature of this. It's Still Sober. I'm John Rabin. If you're a sober person, hope you're staying sober. If you're not a sober person, hope you're staying sane. My sanity is going to be at an all-time high moving forward because tonight was the first episode of Hard Knocks focusing on the Chicago Bears training camp. I'm a huge Chicago Bears fan, have been for a while, because I am of that age that you got to see the 85 Bears. Get to see Jim McMahon wearing sunglasses and drinking a beer and not giving a shit about the reporters, which my family didn't particularly care for. I thought was really cool because at the time I was probably 11 or 12. And I was like, that guy's really cool. And then, of course, the Super Bowl shuffle and William Refrigerator Perry, et cetera, et cetera. So I like the Bears. But we didn't get a whole lot of Bears coverage in Texas. You didn't see a whole lot of their games. So after a while, I just kind of let it go and I settled for whoever else I could watch. I liked playing the Steelers on Tecmo Bowl Super Bowl. And as a result, I convinced my brother to be a Steelers fan. He's still a Steelers fan. I like the Steelers because of their colors. I like the Bears and the Steelers. I didn't know why we rooted for the Cowboys. The Steelers had better uniforms. So it was like, all right, I didn't get it. I mean, yeah, it's the hometown team, I guess, but the Steelers looked cooler. But I always like, you know, and then, so I really got into the Bears. And then a few years later, there was a basketball player named Michael Jordan for the Chicago Bulls. And of course I watched, you know, that. My roommate in college was a huge fan of the Bulls. So, you know, that just basically just reinforced it. And so it's nice because we've got Caleb Williams, number one draft pick, quarterback. I know there's about half to 75% of you who listen to this who don't give a shit about football. But here's the deal. It's my thing. And the only thing that has kept me from looking for a new thing just to pass the time has been the Olympics for the past few weeks. And I've been really thankful for that. But here we go. It's coming up. It is NFL, as I type it in, preseason schedule, preseason games, start. Oh, preseason games start in 2 days. Damn. That should be fun. It should be fun to watch. It'll be really fun to watch the Lions and the Giants play preseason in 2 days, since they've been fighting every day in training camp. So that should be fun. But it basically, here we go. It gets started. And I get a nice distraction. And it's nice to have a distraction that you really, really enjoy. What's not nice is when that distraction is a season. So you only get four, maybe 5 months out of it. Let's see. September, October, November, December, January, February. Ooh. I stand corrected. Five and a half seasons. Five and a half months. 5.5 months of distraction. Along with holidays, whatever. It's great. It's I'm very excited. Olympics has been fun to watch. It's especially Peacock, letting me doing the multi-window. And you got a big monitor. We have like a big TV at work that we just have the four things going on. You just kind of walk by and casually watch sports you would never follow. But all of a sudden you're like, you have great interest in handball or, you know, air rifle, which I've seen a lot of people confused as to why we have no Americans at the top of the game of shooting. I mean, it's all right there. Everybody's like, why shouldn't we? Shouldn't we have the best shooters? But this is what, that's the thing, is that the shooting sport in the Olympics is an air gun. It's like a BB gun or a pellet gun with no loud noise, no kick, no fun. I mean, it's just, if you watch them shoot, you can't even see them pull the trigger. It's just that, you know, it's that sensitive, and they don't, because you don't want to move and throw off the aim and all that. But no, that's not what we do. That's not our shooting. And I don't mean to take it into a dark place, but just people who like guns don't have a collection of air rifles or air pistols. They don't have, would you like to see my BB gun collection? Nobody says that. They don't have a gun rack in their car with pellet guns in there. Now, there's another category in the Olympics involving a gun, and it's called skeet shooting. And you're goddamn right, there's an American who won the gold in that. Easy. And that's what it is. That makes perfect sense. Fucking shotgun. Who's going to handle a shotgun better in the world than a redneck? And that's who won. I saw him. Hang on. Where is he from? Okay, that makes sense. It's, he's from Georgia, and he owns his own shooting range in Texas. And he's won the gold medal for skeet shooting 4 times. Then he served in the Army for 6 years. So he's a serviceman who owns a shooting range in Texas, and he's from Georgia. Yeah, that's a skeet shooter right there. That absolutely is the dude. Absolutely, that makes sense. Why wouldn't he? My wife and I joked like we were, because I watched him and it looked like he didn't even know. He's like, oh, this is fun. Just kind of killing time. He looked like he was just some redneck, like at the Olympic Games. You know, like when you're killing time at a Dave and Buster's and something, and you're like, oh, I'm just going to play a big buck hunter here while I wait around. And he just played a real life version of big buck, you know, skeet shooting. And he's like, oh, just you won. I won what? You won a gold medal. Oh, what a fun little game. I won all these tokens. No, that's Euro. Euro. Anyway, I'm just here for artistic dance and swimming. So, yeah, I'm excited that football's coming and that the Olympics are wrapping up. I'm just waiting around to see if Team USA can get the gold. I am concerned about the Joker and Serbia, and I am concerned about I'm hoping that Germany beats France. I don't want the USA to play fucking France with their dirty ass officials, hometown refs. I'm hoping that France gets beat by Germany, Because, you know, U.S. versus Germany always feels kind of, I don't know, nostalgic. I don't know why I feel that way, but that's seems a little nostalgic. No idea why. In relation to sports, there's a middle school that's near us. I don't know how long that they've had. This is their mascot, but they're the Scotties. They're Scottish. Their team mascot is a Scottish Terrier, which is weird. Are they known to be vicious dogs? Let's see. Scottish Terrier personality. Scottish Terriers are often described as a big dog in a little dog's body. They are feisty, independent, and sometimes excitable. As adults, their behavior can be moody. Some Scotties take to only one person. Scotties can be aggressive with other pets and stubborn about training. All right. So I guess your mascot is the Scotties. It's like, we're really loud. We don't like to do what we're told. I don't know if that's necessarily the fighting Scotties. I don't know if that's necessarily the way you go, but that's odd. This is not, and I'm not trying to lean into the fact that I'm old. I'm like, these kids today, they want a participation trophy. This is a participation trophy mascot. I'm not saying that. I'm thinking it, but I'm not saying it. I mean, part of me thinks it's just kind of like, I think it might be like an art school, though. That's the whole thing. I don't think it's like a regular public school that, because it's a middle school. So it's not like you're not like dealing with, you know, like 16, 17, 8 year olds with a high school team that you're trying to convince them to be, you know, to be feisty and, be a nervous, excitable, loud dog that's under 2 feet. And take that energy to the field, and let's go get a touchdown. I don't think that's the case. It reminds me though what it reminds me of is there was one team me growing up. There was one team, in America, and they were about an hour from us. But in Hutto, there's one school that had, they were the Hutto Hippos. And it was the only school in the country that had a mascot as the Hippos. And it was unfortunate at the time because the only reference that most of us had for hippos were like cartoon hippos and like Disney cartoons and the game Hungry, Hungry Hippos. So growing up, you thought to yourself that the rhinoceros was the dangerous one. That rhinos were the big dangerous things that you want. And hippos are just some fat fuck that nobody gives a shit about. And then that's a really bad call for a mascot. But we didn't have the internet. So while that may be the case, they probably got mocked a lot in the 80s with me growing up. But I know now that hippos are fucking dangerous. I mean, they're huge. They're, you know, they swim really fast. They have sharp teeth. And it says that they kill 500 people in Africa every year, which is insane. Are hippos more dangerous than crocodiles? There's a YouTube video that lets you know. Okay, yeah, that's the whole thing about hippos is that lions kill about 22 people a year in Africa, whereas hippos kill like 500. Jesus Christ, they have a habit of charging at boats and capsizing them. See, that to me, now that's it. Yeah. So Hutto, hopefully they're still, are they still the Hutto hippos? It's like I'm asking you, but you can't answer. Somebody's listening and going and just saying, you know, quietly, yeah, they're still the Hutto hippos. So, yeah, no, they're still the hippos, because that is, that's, yeah, no, that's, they've still got the big Hutto, they've still got a big statue of a hippo. So right in the front, that's pretty awesome. All right. Stay away from them. So I don't have anything to talk about recovery-wise. Maybe it is related to recovery, to my sobriety. I don't know. I do not. Yeah, I don't do stand-up anymore. I haven't quit. I just, you, if you pay me, and, you know, I'll do it. But nobody's calling me. Nobody's messaging me to book me. But I'm not reaching out either. So I don't really consider that retired. I'm not out of the game. Like, if somebody asked me, I wouldn't go, nope, no longer doing it. I would go, yes, I'll take your money. Just give me a window. Like, I won't, you know, you can't call me last minute. But the thing about it is that I was thinking about this because I mentioned the football is a distraction. I like having distractions. There's things that interest me that it's shifting. Like, suddenly, now that I've turned 50, I am actually interested in golf. I like watching it. I'm interested in playing it and all that. And I'll keep you posted as soon as I actually put my plan into, you know, as soon as that gets into motion, I find myself on a golf course playing it, probably after, you know, dipping my toes in the water at Topgolf or some annoying shit. But the thing about it is that, yeah, my interest in stand-up is just kind of dried up. Like, I just, you do it for a while and you just, like, the game kind of changes. And it feels right to kind of shift gears and kind of back away from it. Watch the people that you like, but just kind of, you know, try not to be too judgy. Try not to sound too old. Don't get caught being out of touch. And it's interesting to see people in their 50s become out of touch. Like, it's, you see people who have, some people have aged and continue to perform at a high level. They continue to do it. A lot of people, you know, move on. But then you see people that, you know, they talk a big game and they do put the work in, but they just, because of who you are and where you are in your life, you're just going to come off out of touch. And it's just like, you just kind of go, probably shouldn't have done that. He probably should have just left that there and gone into, probably should have stopped at the last one. I don't want to mention any names, but, I don't know, Joe Coy and Joe Rogan kind of come to mind. It's just like, it's just a little step behind. It's just like, man, you sound like this particular special is a few years old. Like, this should have come out 4 years ago or 3 years ago. Like, it's just, it's no new ground. You're just rehashing the opinions of people. I don't understand why people try to push an envelope that has already been pushed. They're just treading the same worn path that people have already said shit. And you're like, you know what? I'm going to say something that nobody has the guts to say. Actually, a lot of people do. They say it on the internet every day. Different comedians have said it on stage every day. Most of them are unfunny because they're trying to make a point. They're trying to say something instead of finding something funny about it. They've forgotten that the whole point is to make a joke about it. And maybe you make a point out of the joke, but you don't make the point first. And then how do I turn that into a joke? You make the joke and then, hey, can I turn this into a point? Maybe. If not, let's move on to the next fucking joke. And I have a friend who wants to try stand up, and despite me telling him multiple times, don't. I said, there's too many comedians. Please don't do it. You're not going to like it. You're not going to be good at it. Nobody's good at it at the beginning. And then I tell him seriously, okay, if you want to do it, just know that it's going to suck and you're not going to do great. You're not going to do good. You're not going to do fine. You're not going to do okay. You're not going to do well, but that's not the reason you go to see if it's something that you want to keep doing, because that's how you know. You go, you do a couple of open mics and you bomb. You can't bring people. It has to be just you, you know, and you bomb, but you've got that taste for it because you're broken and you need the attention. And then you go back. But I told him, I said, look, if you're going to do it, try to write a 5-minute set that you could, that could be put on TV. Content wise. Like, I mean, it doesn't matter if you, you know, if you curse or whatever, maybe work on not cursing so much. But content wise, could it be on TV? Then the reason is not because you're trying to do that, not because you're trying to get on TV. The reason is that people get on stage and they immediately want to tackle the big things. They immediately go like, oh, I'm going to do a joke about abortion or trans rights or, you know, anti-vaxxers or, you know. Can I make a rape joke? Like that kind of stuff. Like, and it's basically the equivalent, trying to do that at an open mic when you're new is like you're a first year med student and you're trying to tackle the brain. Don't go for the brain in your first year. You can't do it. Start off with, like, you know, something like toenails. Like, you got to start off slow. You got to men and women are different, or dogs and cats are different. Like, you got to go low key. Like, you got to take it easy. You got to ease into it. You don't try to beat them, because that they always do that. It's, I don't know why they do. I don't know why they show up and go, I'm going to go on stage and say things I've always wanted to say. You say those things online. You think it's going to translate to a stage? People want jokes. They don't want fucking point of view. They don't want to see the internet on stage. They want to laugh. So, and I think that people forget that. I think the comedians forget, you know, who've gotten big, especially ones who podcast a lot. They've gotten too comfortable. Or they're too big, so they can't work out their shit because everybody's watching them, so they don't work them out as much. Or they've just they've moved on to a different tax bracket, and so all they want to do is tell jokes about the McLaren that they own. And it's like, really, dipshit? You know, it's dumb. So I'm glad I didn't end up being the old guy. I mean, I was, but I didn't, but I was talking, you know, it was, all I was doing was talking about the, about being a drug addict and different stuff. And it was fresh because I was, you know, my first 10 years of sobriety. So I was like working on it and figuring things out, but I was comfortable with it and I had a lot of fun. And, but I'm glad in the way the pandemic gave me that break and realized, yeah, this is a nice place to kind of ease off and kind of back off and figure out if I'm going to do something else, you know? And it was, so it's been nice. And, it's uncomfortable to see people kind of age out of doing good on stage, you know, where the last feel more kind of supportive instead of just like, that's so great. And it's just, and then, you know, it's time for somebody else. It's time for somebody new, time for fresh blood. That's just the way the world works. Some people can keep doing it, but some, like, you see it and you're just like, it's time to go. I think you just need self-awareness. You just need to kind of be aware and be self-conscious so that you're not being the dead horse in some fashion. Now, that is kind of about recovery, because the thing is that that's honestly the only reason that I quit drinking. Like, rehab helped me with the drugs, but drinking, I just drank myself out and I was tired. And I just kind of read the room. I just kind of went, I don't want to do this anymore. I don't want to be the old guy at the bar when everybody else tried to have fun. And they're like, oh God, there's that guy. There's the resident alcoholic, like all the old men in The Simpsons at Moe's Tavern. You don't want to be that guy. Joey Jojo Jr. Shabadoo or whatever. No, you don't want to do that. So. StillSoberPod@gmail.com for any questions or comments that are positive to neutral. Hit me up. Appreciate it. We'll see you next week. All right. Later. Get away, gotta get away, gotta get away, gotta get away, for the Lord called me to stay on.